I don't know why people are comparing themselves to others, because if I can only do 44 push-ups, brother, that's what I can do. And if your entrepreneurs that are younger than me have that sort of goal in mind, not financial, it's the easiest water that will get you through any sort of desert of just having that sort of positive mindset.
Welcome to The Art of Winning. My name is Ashton Levarek, and I've spent the last 21 years working with our nation's most elite athletes, leaders, and warriors. Men and women that live and sometimes even die by the phrase, failure is not an option. As a retired Special Operations Pararescue jumper, a sniper, and combat diver with over 10 combat deployments, as well as a rugby player, a lifelong student of human performance, and an entrepreneur, I have made it my obsession to explore what it truly takes to excel at life. So each week, we will bring you an inspiring person or message to help you win. From the boardroom to the battlefield, from building wealth to living fulfilled, from mastering the mind to human performance, we'll explore the mental disciplines, physical practices, and financial tools employed by the true winners of our time, as well as have fun exploring success and what it takes to win in this thing called life. Thank you for joining me today. Now let's start the show.
Today's guest joins us all the way from Costa Rica, San Jose, Costa Rica, which is actually just 4 hours away from me because I've relocated to Guanacaste, Costa Rica. So I'm northwest of San Jose by about 4 hours. But today's guest, Richard Blank, he joins us from San Jose, Costa Rica. He moved down here when he was 27 years old. He relocated to Costa Rica to actually train employees for one of the larger call centers in San Jose, with San Jose is the capital, with a mix of motivational public speaking, backed by tactful and appropriate rhetoric. He shared his knowledge and trained over 10,000 bilingual telemarketers. Richard Blank is the chief executive officer for Costa Rica's call center since 2008. So he's been doing this for a while. And one of the reasons I want to have him on the show is not just because he's been so successful as an entrepreneur, as a business owner, becoming a CEO and being successful in another country, but the other reason I want to bring him on is because of his experience with calling people, forming a connection over the phone, right? Which arguably, like, you're only using one of your or two of your senses there, right? Your ability to talk and your ability to hear. And or if talking is even a sense, I'm sorry, that's probably not right. But you're relying on conveying information through the phone in order to form a relationship, to then sell a product or convince a client or form a partnership or whatever it may be through the phone, which puts you at a handicap if you're used to doing it through visual senses, reading people's facial features and gestures as you're talking, as well as communicating through facial features and gestures as well, right? So this is definitely an art. And we go over some of his secret sauce, if you will, for forming that relationship, for making that sale, for connecting with that person on the other side of the phone so that you can be successful even by just contacting somebody through the phone. But he's a really interesting person to talk to. We talk about a bunch of different things, from gamification in the workplace to forming relationships both over the phone with your employees as well as potential clients through social media. So I think it's another piece that people will benefit from. But Richard Blank brings a lot to the table. He's got a lot of experience in this field, but he also has the largest collection of restored American pinball machines and Antica Rockola jukeboxes in Central America, which is all part of his gamification. Listen to the end to hear about that part. But Richard Blank holds a bachelor's degree in communications and Spanish from the University of Arizona and a certificate of language proficiency from the University of Sevilla, Spain. He's been a keynote speaker for Philadelphia's Abington High School 68th National Honor Society induction ceremony, and he's big on giving back. So we talk a little bit about that as well, and the power of language and learning another language, what that does for you. But yeah, I hope you guys enjoy the show. Please remember to leave a rating and review. I'd love to hear your feedback and let me know what you think. All right, guys, let's get to the show. What's up, everyone? Welcome back to The Art of Winning. Today, we have a very special guest from my new home country. He's been living here a lot longer than I have. I moved to Costa Rica about a month ago. He's been here, what, you say, 21 years, Richard? Is that right?
23, actually.
23.
Keeps counting. Keeps growing.
Yeah. Yeah. Who's counting? So today we got Richard Blank. He has done what we're trying to do. He's moved to Costa Rica. He's developed his own business. He's developed a lifestyle. He's mastered it. And we're going to share his journey, and we're going to go over some of the things he's learned, both doing that during that, as well as starting a business, starting a call centers, and working in that realm of, or that industry. So Richard, thank you so much for being here today. You have quite the bio, and I'm excited to dive into it.
Yeah, thanks, Ashton. I really appreciate being a guest here. I love the show, The Art of Winning, and you do some very good work. I gravitated towards it, learned a lot of new stuff, and thought I wanted to pay it forward. And that's why I'm here today, to share my tips and tricks.
Awesome. That is awesome. I love that. I love that. Because it's not, there is no one way to the top of the mountain. There's so many different ways to do it. And as we can see from your life, or we'll get into, you've gone a whole different way that many people don't think of doing, moving out of the country to do this. So before we get too deep into that, let's give everybody kind of a background of who you are, where you're from, and what got you to where you are today.
Now, I was proud Northeast Philadelphia boy. And I grew up where Rocky is our king. And so it gives you vigor. And when I graduated Abington High School back in 91, a lot of my friends were moving on to medical school or law school and finding other avenues in Ivy League. I didn't have the grades and the maturity or the structure, but I loved Spanish. And so with that sort of momentum, I got college recommendation letters to encourage me to be a Spanish major. Chose to go to the University of Arizona. So I was a wildcat for multiple years, and took my junior year, and I lived in Spain so I could master the language. Came back and interned for Telemundo postgrad, worked for Corona. And so if you think about it, I was getting a return on investment of the second language, understanding different cultures and getting such a positive feedback that I had to continue. And so guess what? In August of 2000, when I was 27 years old, I was given a one in a million opportunity to move to Costa Rica for just 60 days and work at my friend's call center and teach English. And so when that barn door was open, this filly horse never came back. And so I got past my parents' guilt, decided to make a life here, learn the business from the inside out. And in my mid-30s, I decided to throw my hat in the ring and start my own call center. And actually, this is where we are today.
That is amazing. I love that story of your love of Spanish kind of just kept snowballing into these other things. And in fact, if I read it correctly, because of your love of Spanish, you help people go to college in pursuit of learning Spanish. Is that right?
You've done your due diligence, Ashton. That's why you have such an excellent podcast. Yes. Abington Senior High School, they really offset my poor grades with these college recommendation letters. They believed in me. And so today I do offer a second language scholarship for a graduating senior that wants to pursue this second language degree. And so it's my pleasure to pay for their books freshman year. I look at it like this, and there's nothing wrong with athletics and other sort of academics and other ways people earn scholarships. Man, I knew that grind of learning a second language. I'm Romanian and Russian. No one in my family speaks Spanish. So I really had to start from scratch. And I could see the dedicated practice outside of the call center, kind of like Daniel's son kicking on the beach to practice to fight Johnny in the Karate Kid. The only way to get to certain levels is you got to do it by yourself. You can't always have your sensei and teachers and friends around. A lot of it is it's a self-march. It's that self-journey, that spiritual vision quest. And so I wasn't playing around at 18 years old. My parents looked at me and go, listen, why aren't you going into the family business? Why aren't you following grandpa that went to Harvard Law? Why don't you do your pop's deal and go to Columbia Business School? I go, why don't you follow your older brother and go to Washington and Lee University? I'm like, are you guys kidding? I go, I have to do my own thing. At least what felt natural for me.
Yeah.
Selfish? No, but I was also being, I guess, mature and realistic at that time on really the long-term plan. Actually, not something that would just satisfy someone else's life for me. That just wasn't part of the deal.
I think that's really underrated these days, that you said it's not selfish, but selfish gives us a negative connotation when you go after your dreams, but you are serving yourself, and there's something inside you driving you to go do something, to go do that thing, right? that could be deemed as selfish, but who knows, man? That could be also your higher power, your higher calling, and to deny that self. Imagine what that means later in life, that depression that, I mean, they say 70% of Americans are upset with their, or unhappy with their current profession. Could it be because they're not being selfish enough? Maybe they're not following their dreams. Maybe they're not being clear with what they want out of life and actually taking that action. So I love that you said that, actually. I think that's very powerful. I think that's the key to happiness, is to explore that whole piece. Otherwise, it does become toxic, in my opinion. But yeah, that's
amazing. It's just perspective. You could be in a circle of people that are negative or never experienced it. You and I are experiencing being expats, moving to Costa Rica. There's so many things we can share with each other that's essential.
Yeah.
But I tell you what, think about it like this. I was entering into a Latino culture of a different language, different sometimes religion and traditions. And so really it's starting from scratch. And if you're able to integrate, and if people are accepting, and if you're showing good faith, and you're studying the grammar tenses and really trying, and people are balancing your bike, it's something my family could not relate to. My great-grandparents could, because they came to the United States at the turn of the 20th, right? And they were in New York, and they were in the garment industry, and they made their money during the Depression. My argument to my parents was, we're nomads. I'm just not moving this way. I'm moving this way. And I'm using that second language like great-grandpa did. And I'm following my dreams like they did.
Yeah.
And so how could you stop that when, once again, we hold our great-grandparents' word and actions as gospel? So in essence, I was really following in family tradition, not for the current family business in the United States, but the blood that we have to expand and to meet other people and to experience life. And that was driving me.
Yeah.
And they couldn't understand that. And so the more that I could relate in a second language and show interest, these people realized it wasn't a parlor trick or patting me on the head and saying, that's funny and cute. They realized I was on to something. And it was enabling me to follow, as you say, that dream, where if you speak a second language, it's really a ball. There's 360 to it. It's not just one line or five things that you need to plug in or be around. A second language is universal. The world is your playground when it comes to this. And so it was much more fun with me. It was more stimulating constantly compared to just waiting for a class or a band to get together or going to the movie. Yeah. This was 24/7, especially in Tucson, Arizona, when everyone's speaking Spanish everywhere.
Yeah. Yeah. Just to relate, we come from some common paths there, but I think that's my family. There's a huge travel bug. Like, we all travel a lot. My mother was a flight attendant. My father, on my mother's side, all the men were in the military or pilots. A lot of traveling. My wife speaks a couple languages well, both my kids dual language. But I think, and you know what I hear when you're saying that, the power of learning a second language, it does. It opens up so many other paradigms. It opens up so many other realms for you, for travel, for lifestyle, for experiencing the world, instead of just being closed off and limited to your only form of communication, which is the one you're born with. Because I grew up speaking French. I moved to France. I did all sorts. I was a bartender over there for a little while in between the military. I've been all over the world with the military as well. But like, that language barrier is what keeps people from experiencing that a lot of time, because of the fear of it, right? Because of the fear of interacting. And it is amazing. It can be a huge window, a huge doorway into a whole nother world. And yeah, it is fun. It can be a lot of fun. All right. So I want to get into, so why call centers? It was just because the job that you were given, or was that something
that went through it? Yeah, yeah, it could have been anything, but I found it interesting. There's two sides to the call center side. It's like Master Blaster in Mad Max Beyond Thunderdome.
Yeah.
You have the technical machine side, but the predictive dialer is like an automatic pitching batting cage, and these sort of metrics and control to enhance someone, like Rocky IV, Ivan Drago. You put machine into a man, you make him stronger.
Yeah.
So I respected these headsets, noise canceling, and it was cool, but it wouldn't put you into the end zone. You needed that soft skill especially if English was your second language. Imagine that sort of intense concentration and translation to be able to have these conversations. So I was really respecting these highly educated and skilled call center agents that were converting calls. Never seen that before, just what Hollywood showed you. And then I said, hey, I kind of have a Billy Madison advantage. I'm a native speaker. So I see a grammar suggestion or advanced vocabulary that's more diplomatic, and just maybe not being exhausted of the intense translations during the day. It's kind of, for me, it's second nature. And really, in essence, I was starting off on third base. And I took it a step further because in my communication studies, one of the coolest things were these controlled environments for focus groups. Now, a lot of the textbooks were just reading about studies they did in the 40s, 50s, and 60s when they would just watch people. But I like consistency in order to see inconsistency. And working at my friend's center and taking tens of thousands of calls and analyzing them, you start noticing patterns, especially when you're talking about sight unseen. So you're losing three of your senses over the phone, your taste, touch, and smell. And I would see that these sort of listening skills were enhanced. And especially when people started speaking with more descriptive vocabulary, more adjectives, they were really painting a picture with their voice to capture the attention of somebody over the phone or to try to explain something. And then I realized that most people were being lazy, or they just overlooked the fact that this sort of medium, which we've only been doing for, let's say, 100 years, right? The phone hasn't been around for 1,000. So it's still new for us. And I wanted to preserve that sort of delicate art of speech so you don't get burnt out, so you don't look down upon it, so you don't laugh about it where it's a transitional job that most people do. Realize this, my good friend, that on a phone call with somebody, you could get an upsell, you can get a referral, you can retain a client, or even the most mature way to look at it, it could be an exit interview where somebody could actually take the time to tell you what your competition had done in order to earn their business. And these are the sort of things you will not get today with omni-channel non-voice support, where things are done in chat and email. You are really reducing that sort of value of the client and that sort of interaction and feedback. You might think it's more productive in a certain way where it's hand-off, but in my personal opinion, my friend, I'd rather have a home-cooked meal than some hot pocket that you put in a microwave that tastes 5 years old. People want this sort of experience in anchoring and relationships with people. They just don't want to seem like a computer. But what about AI, they say, Ashton? Well, I tell you what, pal, AI can take you 90% there, but if you need that hug or somebody that really understands you or your best friend that will say, I'm sorry, or I care, or I love you, if a computer tells you that they love you, that's one of the most insulting things you've ever heard in your entire life. They'll never be able to get that human touch, personal approach that relationships have. And so I always believe that my industry will not be a buggy whip. It might be reduced and adjusted accordingly, but there will always be some people that press zero that would love to speak to somebody to give them their business. And those are the sort of things that I'm looking at these days that have been adjusting and changing.
That was amazing. It brings up a lot of questions. I was going to ask, that was my next question, what about AI? But you answered it. I do want to go back to how you talk to people to create that connection. Because like you said, you essentially on the phone, you no longer have your sight. You no longer have, which is a huge part of communication, reading other people's facial and gestures, right? You no longer have what, smell, taste, touch. It's all hearing. So how are you making that connection? How do you tell people to make that connection, to build that picture, to engage with people so that they do give you that information, so that they do pay for your services or whatever? Like, there's obviously a lot going into it, and you've given it a lot of thought. I can tell just by how you talk about it.
I'll do two things for you and your amazing audience. I'll give you a few parlor tricks. I have to at least share some soft skills with your audience. So I'll give you your first 30 seconds of a call to give your audience some structure and some stuff. And then, my friend, I'm going to give you my secret sauce. I'm actually going to teach your audience when someone is lying to you, because I believe the purest form of speech is phonetics. physically somebody can manipulate their voice and body and stuff. They do it all the time, but I think the purest form is the speech. But we'll get to that in a minute. Let's just say your audience needs to make a prospecting outbound phone call. In order to reduce the stress, maybe do some due diligence. Why don't you look at a LinkedIn profile or a website? Let's use me for an example. If you look up my company, you'll see my pinball machines, my Art Deco building, neon marquees. You mentioned that sort of stuff. You got 5 minutes with me. It's yours to lose. But let's just say that someone's on a predictive dialer, or just carpet bombing, or just making their phone calls and don't have the luxury to look into that stuff. Well, the first thing you could do is a company name spike. Say the name better than the person that answers the phone. Hey, how's the Art of Winning podcast doing today? You're not going to hang up on me. It's my first impression. I'm saying something that you know, which is your company. It sounds like I've been there before. So let's say it reduces their ego defense or their sort of trance from a 10 to, let's say, a 6. So then they're going to say, who are you? Well, that's a buffer boomerang technique. I need to buffer that negative tone and boomerang it back positive. So I say, hey, Ashton, that's an excellent question. My name is Richard Blake. I do a name drop, let you know it's an excellent question. Glad you brought it up. Repeat the question to show active listening and take your negative tune, put it into a positive tune and send it back to you. It's readjusting tone so I can buy some time. And then finally, before I get transferred over into the decision maker, I will let the individual that assisted me know that they were amazing. I'll do it verbally. And I'm also going to do it in writing so I can give this gatekeeper, the ones that you're so afraid of, the dragon that breathes fire. If I give them a positive written and verbal escalation to their boss, hey, that will separate me from 999 other people that are prospecting their business. Secondly, when I do the Richard Circle call your business back, Ashton, this individual will remember me, thank me for that compliment, give me more company culture and add to my momentum. But let's get back to the transferred call. Instead of doing the company name spike again, I'm doing the positive escalation. I'm going to let the business owner know how great Ashton was. He's not going to know who I am. His defense goes from a 10 to like a 2. He'll be like, who is this? Who's Mr. Sunshine calling me? So now it's not even a buffer boomerang. And we're like, hey, Mr. Jones, so glad that you asked. Richard Black, Costa Rica's call center. And that's your first 30 seconds. Yeah, but what about the 10-minute cold call close? Bro, you don't have the other 9 minutes, 30 seconds because it doesn't exist yet. Unless you can anchor and buy some time in the beginning and do these sort of skills, which aren't going to compromise your ethics, you're not going to get transferred. You're not going to get the appointment. And so I can go over other skills in the body in the conclusion of the call, but we're not there yet. Daniel's son needs to know how to balance and kick and wax on, wax off before we get to that next stage. But my good friend, if everybody can jump clouds and have romantic deaths of company name spikes, positive escalations before someone says we're good and hang up, that's how you keep your momentum. That's how you cross deserts. And so if you can keep that sort of mindset when doing these calls, don't be surprised that the mass doesn't get adjusted, where you're clipping about 80% compared to reject 80%. You start getting good at this. Yeah, but I didn't close the deal. I don't care. I got transferred 3 times and people love me there. And don't be surprised if they don't call you back 5 months later because they remember you. That's what you do. And that's a nice start for people. Now let's get to the secret sauce. The secret sauce. I love the fact that you brought up sight unseen. Brilliant of you. So let's focus on this right now, not what you're seeing in body language. We can talk about spacing, proxemics, touch, facial aesthetics, the colors and stuff. No, let's go pure. Let's go into the alma, the soul. So phonetics, the sound of speech, which means it could be done in any language, even animals, right? I break down phonetics into 4 sections. You have a tone, rate, pitch, and a duration. Your tone, in my opinion, needs to be the consistent variable. In my experience, the best sort of positive reinforcement I got is when I had a confident and empathetic tone, kind of like a doctor, an attorney, or a parent. Think about it. Confident and compassionate.
Yeah.
Well, what about mirror imaging? Great question, Ashton. I'm not going to mirror image negative. I'm going to say Mr. Right. Positive because that doesn't wiggle. I'm going to match how fast and how loud you go. We call that rate and pitch or level. OK, Okay. So let's just think of eighth grade pre-algebra, where you have an XY chart. That is the phonetic micro-expression reading. And it's quite simple, my friend. You have positive and negatives, loud, fast, and low and slow. Just using me and you as an example, we're definitely in quadrant one. When we get excited, we go fast to an eight, might get louder. But usually we're around a six or a seven in regards to where we're at. And so I look for spikes and dips. When do I do this? Every 30 seconds. Why? Because that's usually the average attention span and turn taken. Mm-hmm. What are you talking about, Richard? Calm down, Ash. Besides doing your job, asking questions, closing the deal, looking up info, everything you do on a phone call, subconsciously, which will not ruin your rhythm or your cognitive state, you can still put that subcategory of sound and speed. It's true. And that when you're doing a first time read with somebody, you'll see a spike or a dip. And in my opinion, after let's say 3 or 4 or 5 minutes of this, because you will see consistencies and matchings, that's when I've suggested to my agents to interject and ask clarification or tie down questions, things if they make sense or sounds good right, or asking open-ended questions so the client can deduct, reduce, and allow us to prioritize. It's a dance. It's a simple dance. We're a rudder of your ship. And as long as we can see these things, but then you say, okay, I understand your tone, and I understand the rate and the pitch. You mirror image that because it's your dancing to see if you spike or dip. What's the true tell sign? Here's the irony of it. Silence, tone, rate, pitch, duration. What happens if someone is not speaking? That to me is the largest tell sign. Follow me here, my brother. I can manipulate my tone. I can be angry at you. I can speak faster than you, slower, louder, or softer. We can manipulate this all day long. But you know perfectly well, you cannot manipulate an answering speech. Yeah, I can wait 5 seconds every time. Yeah, what happens if I put a mouse in front of you? You'll scream in a second. That's usually when the police show you the evidence. It's the third or fourth time because all the other stuff is so manipulated. It's the subconscious that kicks.
Yeah.
It's the real tell sign. Yeah, but the movies, yeah, that's the stuff you're watching. Yeah, you see the guy clicking a pen or scratching during poker. That's 99.9999% of the movies. I'm telling you, my brother, you be in that movie, you close your eyes. I'm going to give you that 0.01% really bullseye shot of when someone's lying to you. And it's consistent with the visual as well. In fact, not consistent because their audio will not be matching the visual. Everyone in the red herring will be looking over here, but Ashton the astute will be looking over here. That's where they do the trick. That's the trick. That's the trap door. You can't control your answering speed. You're lucky if you do it 4 out of 10 times. Mientras, during your call, my brother, when all this dancing is going on, clarification, raking, everything. The true tell sign if someone is lying to you is that answering speed. And you know when I usually catch them. This is my favorite part. When someone will ask for the phone number, I'll give you the phone number. And then I'll say, wait a second. Something don't smell right. I go, hey, Ashton, would you mind repeating it for me just in case I made a mistake? And they're like, man, you didn't even write that phone number down. I got you. You weren't being serious. And so I'm not saying it happens on every call, but if you want to put your chips on the table and guess it.
Yeah.
Most of the time you're correct when someone is doing these things. And those would be my at least base structure for those that are looking to at least initiate a conversation, anchor with somebody ethically, where you can really show not just attention, but true interest in what somebody is doing. And I think little by little will increase your odds to convert that call into a client.
That's amazing. And I just want to clarify, you're saying the speed at which they answer a question will help you determine if they're lying or not?
That's the purest form, my brother. I'm going to go with you on this one. Let's look again. Yell at me, curse at me, interrupt me, angry or nice with me. Tone, rate, pitch, manipulation. Does hot water scald you? Do you hate jumping into ice cold water? Have you ever been pricked with a needle? Has someone ever scared you in a spooky house?
Yeah.
You ever lose yourself to a sweet smell of ecstasy? I mean, it's just, there are certain things where you can't help but your body to shake or react or,
yeah.
I've had weird sensations before for certain stimulation of taking a shot in a bar to eating spicy food to someone giving you a hug and you want to hug an extra second. It's, man, there are things you just can't do 10 out of 10 times.
Yeah.
And it's amazing to see a grown man cry. Don't be surprised. And so I'm just trying to let you know that in my experience, the purest form is someone not knowing their timing because everything else is masked.
Yeah.
And rehearsed until you get surprised or you have to be spontaneous at the moment. Or how about this? It's always the greatest thing. When Jerry Springer or Oprah Winfrey would bring out that special guest.
Yeah.
And that person would see them, their strong demeanor turns into a crying child for hugs and memories and can't wait. And so, come on, man, you tell me. Look at Rose, what was it, Rosebud and Citizen Kane. Guy's the multimillionaire, and all he could think about was that red sled. So you tell me, my man, I could take that. That thing was priceless to him. All his riches in the world didn't matter. And you wouldn't understand that unless you were in that individual's shoes. And so we're just trying to do first-time reads, my man, and seeing if I can just uncrack some codes with people that are trying to put up some fronts or so black and blue from people trying to sell them things. And so just trying to get you to be real for a minute, man, and just at least give me the benefit of the doubt so at least we get to know one another. And it's not fair that I'm judged on what somebody else has done when I wasn't even there yet.
Right.
And so by showing this good faith in the beginning, I'm not even introducing my company yet. I said the name of your company and I just gave your secretary a positive escalation. This is the first 30 seconds to a minute prior to even my company. So I'm just giving you free samples of sesame chicken at the mall, man. Take as many toothpicks as you want. I know you're going to buy it. You love it. And just allow me to let you calm down for a minute, seriously, and get out of this trance that you're in. That's all.
Yeah. No, I love it. I love it. And I think, and obviously you have it, it's, you made it into an art. You made it into an art of speaking, of complimenting. And that's that positive. I feel it when you talk, because there's definitely a positive connotation to your voice. I don't have all the, I can't articulate it like you can because you have more knowledge on it, but I can definitely feel it. And I'm thinking that's what you want your callers to do and or your clients to or potential clients to feel. You want them to feel comfortable with who they're talking to. You want them to be receptive to, yeah, upsell to whatever that is. But yeah, I can feel it just by the way you talk. Absolutely.
Has to be sincere. Listen, you're a smart enough cat to know that I was pulling one over on you. Your audience doesn't know. You do a full filtering interview process prior to being on your respectable podcast. So trust me, there's a lot of people that unfortunately were turned down for this. I'm very happy to be on this today. But as I say, as long as someone is not compromising ethics, and if you are leaving a voicemail or sending an email, do some due diligence. It just, someone will respect the fact. Just stop calling me sir and giving me some template. Put a two or three things in there.
Yeah.
And don't be surprised that increase things coming back. So these are just common sense suggestions that I'm giving people just to be a little more attentive to the work that they're doing.
Yeah. No, I love it. I mean, you hear about this. You hear about those kind of tactics, I guess, too, from many other people. Doing due diligence on who you're going to talk to is huge. That way you can make that connection and talk about what who that person is. And people repeat that all the time. But yeah, absolutely. I agree. I want to shift a little bit here too, because you, and when I was reading up on some of the, your bio that I have, you talk about gamifying. Can you expound on that a little bit?
Wasn't your favorite class in school recess, Ashton?
Oh yeah. Oh yeah.
What were the games back in the day? Kickball, capture the flag.
Dodgeball.
What you guys doing back in the school yards?
And what, dodgeball, kickball. Yeah. Capture the flag. A lot of chance. Yeah.
You made your best friends there. You let off steam. I mean, I don't know why when you hit middle school, they stopped doing it. It's not cool. They might have given you physical education, but who wants to be gross for the rest of the day? You're supposed to be talking to chicks. So this is what I thought about. This is an environment where people needed to meet individuals from other departments. The beauty of it is I'm an avid collector of classic American pinball machines.
I read that.
So, man, as much as they say, yeah, I played it on the computer, come on, get on a real machine from 1977. Tell me what you think. And it also, which is very funny, it allowed the, besides breaking bread with them and training and walking the roads, through the medium of pinball and Pac-Man and air hockey, the agents bonded with me because there's a little smack talk. They can be competitive without repercussion. I can show them they're in my wheelhouse, so I totally kick their butt when we're playing these games. But it's a moment for them. It's, as I mentioned before about the answering speed, they put their guard down and laugh, and then realize they did laugh, or they touched my shoulder, which sometimes is appropriate in the moment. Do you understand?
Yeah, yeah.
And then they go, they look at me, and I look at them, and I go, you see, buddy, we're bonding. They're like, okay, I get it now. I go, that's what I have this for. It's not just for me. I'm not Willy Wonka. And
yeah,
I needed to almost force them to play because they're growing up too fast. You have plenty of time to lose your hair and have a mortgage and children. I wanted them to master certain stages and doing that at a comfortable pace. I wanted to give them foundation, make them marketable. And remember, you're here in Costa Rica. We compete against Amazon, HP, Intel, Oracle, and dozens of other of the largest call centers that you could imagine with all of the bells and whistles. But I tell you what, people come here to get known so I can delegate. I can have them sit in on meetings to learn about decision making and accountability and time management. And well, what about earning an extra dollar an hour? Come on, buddy. Down the road, perfectly well, you'll be worth an extra $100 an hour if you learn these skills. But how am I ever going to learn it? Show active interest. Be coachable. Be somebody that can at least show up on time, pen at the ready, and looking up additional vocabulary and showing me that they're doing above and beyond. And those are the sort of budding flowers that you work on because they've never really had the right coach, teacher, or mentor before. Really have it. And these YouTube videos don't substitute for the real thing.
Yeah.
And you and I, my friend, are old school baseball hockey coach kind of guy that tells you what to do, how to skate backwards, and how to do slap shots. And I needed those sort of coaches that balanced bikes. And they had to do it the old school way where we call the balls and the strikes. And sometimes, Ashton, we give this little bit of Philly guilt to let them know that they are better than that. And I will compare them to when they were their best and remind them of their coming of age moments of what got them to that stage. And that's what I do because that's what worked with me, because I can never compete against Jeff Bezos's pockets and IT support and his billboards and buildings and buses and bonuses.
But I think
what I can do is not give them walk of shames and support them, my friend. And that's how I'm able to build these businesses.
Yeah. And but what I'm hearing too, though, is, or what I'm, maybe I'm reading too much into it, but it's about building a relationship with your, who you're coaching, building a relationship with your employees through the games that allows the connection and opens receptivity probably and helps them to be more coachable.
How else do we compete? They have on-site doctors, transportation, cafeterias, flexible schedules, multiple locations. Yeah. What do we do? What do I do is I know Billy's name and I'll listen to your calls.
Yeah.
And when you were on the phone and you converted the call and you got transferred to Ashton and you listened to him and you took copious notes and you wrote a beautiful follow-up email that had some really detailed meeting minutes for certain target dates and checkpoints so you can marinate that lead, put it in your pipeline. And the fact that you asked military alphabet to ensure that you didn't forget a letter in there, and it's just, in your military, that's pretty wicked because you can meet some people that have served and you respect what they've done. My grandfather, uncle, and father served, and whenever I have people here that have served in the United States military, I once again give them heroes' welcomes. And they're incredible individuals that have so much leadership and structure to teach us. And so I think everybody can add an ingredient to the stew in one way or another. And if somebody can excel in one area, then by all means, that's their strength of the A-team. Not everyone could be the face man like you and me, and we need to figure out right bus, right seat, Ashton, where these individuals feel comfortable so they don't leave you. That's the challenge that we have.
Yeah, that's amazing. That's amazing. We're still in the process of building our team, and it's always been a struggle finding the right people for the right seed, right? I've liked the gamification of it. We do some of that in the workplace, but one of the issues we've had is half of our team is virtual. My partner, my brother, lives in Phoenix with his wife. Now, me and my wife are here, and then we have a couple of VAs and virtual assistants who we work hand in hand with in the Philippines. And so that has been a struggle, connecting with and encouraging and, of course, inspiring, because you want your people to be inspired. It makes better work. Like, we want them to develop and grow, obviously. I don't want everything to just be checklists and a paycheck. It makes it boring. But yeah,
you can't do the physical because you're all not together, right? And you're not going to be playing some sort. So why don't we do storytelling? That's always the best. At my fraternity, we used to have good and welfare. We give advice to the younger kids, right, on how to have a better time in college.
Yeah.
And so we can't do that in the office, but what they can do is have a Hall of Fame call, Hall of Fame moment, or maybe someone cracked a code in regards to an email template, or someone got a very unique voicemail back that makes everybody feel good, because that acknowledgement that people rarely get. I call it the extra pickles technique, Ashton. You look at someone's name tag and you say, "Hey, Maria, how you doing today? You look like you make great sandwiches." Don't kid yourself if they don't give you extra pickles. It happens like that. And so maybe showing others through example of when you've spent an extra minute or two on the phone to connect, I think it's an excellent way to share, because that sort of knowledge is worth more than a $5 beer. And then it'll give you guys a chance, if you want to, like as a fraternity or sorority, to start teasing a little bit, nicknaming a little bit, mystery science theater it a little bit, where you throw in your jokes when they're talking. And that's a great way virtually for you to high five and bond and laugh and have that sort of team meeting once a week where you have your powwow. Where, like in kindergarten, it was show and tell. Everyone's got to bring something to the table each week. That's interesting. Does it work related? I don't know. If you did something outside of work that you think could make it, maybe instead of being on the phone or retaining a client, you had the experience as the opposite. You were the client. And someone at a restaurant did something, or at a store, they didn't do something. And you, at your company culture, tried to resolve the issue in your way. And you got a chance to see what your sort of attitude and professionalism, what the result was when you're dealing with someone that's cursing and pointing fingers and making a scene. It's just an excellent reinforcement for your values of your team. And maybe you are showing what happens when you go outside the office and what happens when you have your spring in your step. Maybe if you do get that free dessert, you should share everybody on Friday and go, "Listen, man, I complimented Susie because she was having a tough day in the restaurant and we let her know to take her time. And we're not in any rush, and we're a good client, and we love coming here." I don't know, man. If you just want to write books on business and crack those sort of codes, that's fine. But if nobody comes to your birthday party, you have no friends. So whatever sort of theories you have of business and banking, it doesn't work. I still think it's the human element. And every time we can connect with people in 1,000 different ways that can be applied inside the office, that's what makes you a genius. That's why they're still talking about Willy Wonka to this day.
Yes. Yeah. No, that's brilliant, man. That is brilliant. I think you're absolutely right, because it is the human element. And whether you know it or not, you're always looking for that connection. When somebody says, I mean, you see it down here in Costa Rica real quick. If you say, "I'm from the U.S., an expat," and somebody else in the room is an expat, you'll find each other really quick. We're looking for that connection subconsciously, right? Whether it's through language. Like, well, I met some Canadians and they spoke English, and naturally we became best friends because everybody else was speaking Spanish. Like, we're looking for that connection. So if you can seek out and offer the connection early on, That's what I'm hearing you say. You reinforce it, especially with your employees, with your the people you work with. I think that's powerful. I like that, the storytelling too. I think that's really good.
Well, I asked them to write me a coming of age moment on their resume, which looks well too rehearsed. Come on, man. Bells and whistles. It's a bells and whistles store. There's no difference to it. So it's like Indiana Jones in that one cup. That was the only old one. But turn your paper over, Ashton, and give me a coming of age moment when you beat up a bully or saved a kitten. So I can give you a nickname. I can pump you up on a rainy Wednesday. And I can just see if you have debt, because your $100,000 account client may want to ask you an actual question prior to signing a contract.
Yeah.
Are you capable of giving a Dead Poet Society answer? Can you be spontaneous? Can you let them know you beat up a bully in sixth grade? Tell them a story, damn it. Because that's who they want to do business with. Because if not, we're just a print, like everybody else, carpet bombing those lists, hoping for those metrics and not to get fired. Or some supervisor that used to be the most amazing rock star on the phone that had passion. They took them off the phone to think that they could train an army. And all you did was put the bull out the pasture. And now he's miserable screaming at people with coffee breath all day. And you see what they do to these old warriors that just wanted to be left alone. You're not doing it right. You got to make sure your agents are on a level playing field. Give them the resources that they need. Listen to the QA. Give them good coaching. Make suggestions in a certain way, because sometimes people are sensitive or something outside the office is affecting them that day. So everyone needs to relax a little bit of that wiggle room. It's an interesting sort of balance, especially since you and I are guests in this country. I try to do it where, A, showing good faith, but B, if I need to, I do have my certain people in place that are native, local, and can speak the tongue. And they can be my porte-a-porters. They can do it for me. And so I'm willing to allow people to speak for me as well. Naturally, I understand what they're saying. I am bilingual, but it's not the point. Sometimes it needs to go to that stage. And if you're willing to allow people to work with you, and then by all means, as I say before, you will be able to expand your network down here and meet the right people.
Yeah, that's amazing. So I've got a lot on that. Now, I don't want to run out of time here, but
man, I got all the time. You keep going. Yeah. I want to see if I could be your longest podcast. Come on, I saw your 1 hour, 15 minute guy.
So I do a lot of stuff on that. We're kind of getting into the selfish questions from somebody. I have questions. I'm trying to build a big business here. We don't necessarily, our business isn't focused in Costa Rica. My life is focused in Costa Rica. So it's not, my clients are not Costa Rican, essentially. What we do is we buy real estate. We invest in real estate in the U.S. We're going to start doing it. We're going to start doing it here in Costa Rica as well. And so there's a long-term vision with that. But essentially, we buy real estate with investors, and we provide a good return, and we buy these big buildings and stuff. But one of the things that has helped us in finding clients, just like just about every other business out there, is social media. And one of the things I find in social media, and you just said this, in establishing rapport, in establishing a connection, was telling a story. And so I find a lot of times the successful social media posts we do are telling a story. And it's not just like, oh, this is how you can become a millionaire. This is how you can buy your first investment property. A lot of times it's, this is how I did it because I am this. And then everybody that connects with that story wants to learn more. They want to be coached by you. They want to invest with you. They want to partner with you. They want to bring you opportunities. And so I think what you're saying is very important in building your business, as well as in, because it started out, I was asking about how to inspire and motivate and my employees. But what I'm also hearing is it recruits a lot of clientele. That's what I'm making the connection there. I'm not sure if everybody else is that's listening, but that's what I feel in that piece too, because I handle a lot of the marketing as well. And I think that is a very powerful piece, what you're talking about there.
Smoke and mirrors. Clickbait. I know you're better than that. And number two, I don't think you could look at yourself in the mirror and know that's how you're earning your business. And third is, how long could you juggle that? How long can we keep up with that? And it's just, it's not fun living that sort of life. The easiest thing is the truth. And so even if you capture 0.1%, you'll still be a millionaire in this business, or you're not looking to gobble it all up. And
yes,
I like to act my wage. Sure, I like to put my chest out, but it's my chest. I'm just not laggard. But I'm not saying that I'm Iron Man or Batman with an extra suit.
Sure.
And so there's nothing wrong with having that sort of vigor and being bold and standing behind your values. Because like the Statue of David, he's not wearing anything, but it's one of the most powerful images of man that's ever been created.
Yes.
And so he doesn't... I like who I am, and I can't do certain things that other companies do just because maybe I don't have the tech know-how, the mathematical savvy, or just don't want to do it. And I like my way. I like things that are systematic and simple. My parents taught me no surprises. I like preventative measures instead of cures. And if I can control my environment of what I am doing, I'm comfortable. The moment that something is out of my control, and I'm not talking my IT department or the weather, but the thing that I spend my life creating, once that gets out of control, or I've compromised something, or I lost a fidelity to it, I don't love it anymore, then we waste it and we had issues.
Mm.
And so prior to this, I really needed to prepare my mental backpack for that journey. And for, it's not sacrifices. These were just adjustments to temperatures and masses, and reactions. And I love the expression, it's character and chaos, how you react to. That's always my favorite part.
I love that.
During COVID, people that I really relied upon ran for the hills with their tail between their legs. And then you had these green freshmen that were wet behind the ears. That stood up to the plate like the strongest of warrior. And I saw such a lion heart that I couldn't help but be humble that somebody would be willing to continue to stand when there was such uncertainty. And so I love seeing people that live life as a romantic, in a sense, where they realize there's a little bit more to life than just how much money you make. Because, Ashton, don't be worried about that. There are people that will always have enough to have a roof over your head, a full belly, and a warm bed at night. How many meals can you really eat? At the end of it all, I really think it's about other things in life. And so I was fortunate enough to earn enough to be very comfortable. So I'm not worried about that. So it allowed that portion of my mind to think of more recess and more paying it forwards and more compliments and just having a spring in my step, because life's a beautiful thing, man. And I don't know why people are comparing themselves to others, because if I can only do 44 push-ups, brother, that's what I can do.
Yeah,
and that's that. But it's easier said than done. It took a lot of years to get to where I am today. But I tell you what, for the second half of my life, so I'm going to be, got my other 50 years to live, I'm going to live it very happy and satisfied and fulfilled. And it's a very nice place to be. And if your entrepreneurs that are younger than me have that sort of goal in mind, not financial.
Yeah.
It's the easiest water that will get you through any sort of desert, of just having that sort of positive mindset. Yeah.
Richard, I think what you're, I'm writing a book right now geared towards the modern alpha. And it, the premise is much of what you're talking about. It's self-actualization. So if you look at Maslow's hierarchy of needs, you kind of walked through that just now. What you were talking about, you have at the base level, it's like food and shelter, and it goes up, and it's like, it just keeps going up until the top. You have enough of everything that you can actually start expanding upon your spiritual, your mental, that's self-actualization. And I find that's exactly what happens when people get, can figure out how to be okay with where they are, then they can figure out their spiritual, their mental, right? But a lot of us get stuck in this, I don't have enough money, I need more money, because we're comparing ourselves to many other people, right? And like you said, you're talking about doing 40 push-ups because that you're okay with that because that's you and you like you. And whereas what everybody else does, especially with social media and internet these days, is they see that guy just did 100, that other guy did 20, that this guy did, well, whatever, 50. And they're unhappy
with the riot.
Yeah.
Achilles heel.
And they never get to actually develop because they're not okay with it.
You have to, let's look at certain things. We took out the Kraken, didn't we, with the head of Medusa? You have Achilles heel, David and Goliath. The skyscrapers could be taken down with one bomb on the bottom. It happens. Look at Luke Skywalker, Death Star. I mean, come on.
Yeah.
I could care less about the size. A lot of the times it's the strategy and the heart and just the planning. Come on, man. You do know that one spark in incendio. I'm going to share something.
Yeah.
You know, when you put your head on the pillow, that's your clarity time. And as much as you might be surrounded with people, even in the largest rock concert, you could almost still feel alone.
Absolutely.
You came into this world and leaving this world. These are forced personal marches, no matter how many people you surround yourself with, and friends and likes and followers and subscribers. I've had to make the toughest decisions, biggest decisions by myself. Mommy can't save you. Daddy can't help you. Brothers and sisters, best friends. Wow. It's all here. And even physiologically, your body.
Yeah.
And so it's all you. It's 1,000% you. There are outside influences, and fine, you could be in torture, you could be in paradise, you could be in both places. You could be fed or starved, hot or cold. I mean, it's very interesting in the military how they train people for torture. They say the majority of it is just mental. And then at some point you almost want it because it gets you to continue to move on. It's almost like the burn in the gym that you have, or when some people need to stay up or study or do something to such past the limit to hit that sort of clarity. And you wonder why people get out of deserts, the ocean, and they survived when they should have been dead. And so I think people are trying to tap into it. It's almost like the movie Flatliners when they're trying to tap into what happens when you dream or when you die.
Yeah.
And so people are always pushing limits, but I don't want to push limits through heavy drug use or putting myself into any sort of situation where physically I could die. But I do know this, man, that during those times, it really was me making that choose your own adventure decision. So stop blaming your folks or guilt or any sort of thing that you think is influencing your decision. You know perfectly well you should have made a right. But it's each its own, my brother. And I support anybody that can at least start making their bed in the morning or doing anything to start doing that sort of self-love, right? So they can then concentrate on others.
Yeah, that's amazing. I think that's very powerful, the self-love piece. And I think also with the self-love comes the faith in the self, right? If you don't believe in yourself, you won't take those actions. You won't get up and make your bed without asking for help. And you won't even dream. You won't even dream big, right? You won't even dream for a better life because you don't even allow yourself the possibility. But I do think it starts with self-love. You have to be okay with yourself. And then little by little, you will have that faith and take that action and then be able to move forward and move the needle.
It's a dangerous game. You don't want to get into the water with that. Follow me here.
Yes.
Someone close to you that you love might be doing that. You just don't want mental hijacking or you drowning. It's a weird sort of give and take. And some people might expect it was a folie à deux or madness for two, where sometimes you love someone so much you're willing to jump off a cliff for them. Mm-hmm. And I've had to give portions of myself, but I've done it enough to where, kind of like Wilson and Tom Hanks in that movie, I still needed to hold on to some sort of rope to get me back. I couldn't completely let go. But I tell you what, I'll give you a great movie. You remember The Color of Money? It was the second one after Minnesota Fats, which was The Hustler. Anyway, you have Paul Newman as Fast Eddie, who's this amazing cool hustler, and he's playing against Forrest Whitaker, who just looks like the average guy hanging out in a pub. This guy schools him. And then at the end, he looks at Fasada and goes, hey, do you think I should lose some weight? I really didn't understand that because Forrest is a larger man, but no, my good friend, it's in essence, it's almost like a gambling term. It's besides even the gambling term of weight and odds and those percentages, it's really about weight on your back. Because if you can take off that weight, you can rise. And man, do you know how much weight we're carrying? Do you know how much baggage some people are carrying? Yeah. And I don't know people to give this sort of advice, but you shouldn't be so hard on yourself. If you did something at 5 years old, you would have done it differently at 50. So maybe put $10 on the counter and pay for that candy bar you might have stolen back in 1979 and let it go. You're a different person now. And so you have to accept and put to bed so you don't have heavy heart certain stages of your life, because that might be blocking some people. That might be some weight that people might need to lose in order to assist themselves.
Yeah, absolutely. I can definitely see that. I think we all do have our baggage for sure. And that is a great question to ask yourself to allow you to identify it too. What is holding me back? What am I still holding on to? That's powerful. All right, Richard. I want to launch into the last four questions. So the first question being, what is one thing you could tell your younger self or somebody aspiring to follow your path? What was one thing you did that really catapulted you in your business, like really 10x'd your growth and allowed you to become who you are today?
Definitely play. Because I extended enough empathy and compassion that people needed to let us to you. They're not robots, they're not expendable, they're not a number. And so as I said before, recess was the best class, you made your best friends. And so I guess I just was a kid that never wanted to grow up.
I love that. And by the way, everybody, if you didn't catch it, I did read in your bio, and you did mention it, Richard, like you have the largest collection of pinball machines. Is that right?
Oh, yeah. I got 15 machines right now. My oldest one's a 1969 Bally's Camelot. Wicked cool. Man, up to Arnold Schwarzenegger, Last Action Hero, and everything in between.
No kidding. We'll have to keep in touch next time in San Jose. Maybe I'll come by. The kids would love that. Okay, next question. What brings you the most joy in life right now?
Two ways. My own self, personal, is when I give myself me time so I can recharge batteries. And then on the flip side, it's what I give. There's energy givers and energy suckers. And so if I can do something and I see that it's making a positive difference in someone's life, I'm exceptionally cool with it.
I like that. All right, next question. What is one thing you do right now for your health? One thing that you found that has really helped you become the man that you are today? Mental.
I'm going to give you a supreme pizza. Can't give you one thing, man. I got a bunch of things. I'm going to give you a bunch of toppings. I work out every day. I do about an hour and a half in my own gym, 45 minutes of cardio, about an hour's worth of weights. Then I do core and I hit a bag. Love it. Okay. Wash my convertible on Sundays, do my pinball marathons. Those are the things that make me happy.
The pinball marathon, is that you just go play every game you have?
Yeah. I mean, I enjoy, besides the restoration, I like cleaning them with my Wildcat 125, which is very specific for air hockey and pinball surfaces. Just letting you know, do not use other products.
Okay.
But I have certain electricians down here that moonlight and are experts in these machines. And so I love to be an apprentice. I love to learn the basics of what to do to maintain these machines. And it is my pure passion, my good friend. It's a great chance for me to enjoy that, feel the machines, let loose a little bit. And it's literally one of the greatest pastimes. If anyone picks up a machine, you should definitely buy one.
Yeah. No, we actually have a couple in one of our Airbnbs in Sedona, Arizona. But I didn't choose them. Like, my wife manages that side. But yeah, I do love a good pinball machine. That's awesome, man. That is really cool. All right, last question. If life was a game, and for you, it sounds like it very much is. If life was a game, how do you measure whether you are winning or not?
Life's a Rube Goldberg experiment. Remember the not electrical machines? Mm-hmm. He tried it 99 times and had to keep adjusting things accordingly so that ball, the spring, and everything knocks into each other. It took him 99 to hit that 100th time. So my life is like a Rube Goldberg experiment. I got everything there. It's fun. It's cool. Everyone enjoys it. But there's just little adjustments here and there so things continue to bounce into one another and move forward. That's my life, my friend, making sure that everything is set up accordingly so this not electrical machine continues to move forward.
That's good, man. A lot of you're a man of many metaphors, you know that.
Watched a lot of TV back in the 70s and 80s.
Yeah. That's great. All right, Richard, this has been a really interesting conversation. I really appreciate you coming on the show. If somebody wanted to get in touch with you, learn more from you, how can they reach out?
Well, they got to do exactly what you did and get a plane ticket and fly to Costa Rica so they can meet me and Ashton. What are you kidding? Poor Vita. But now I have a very large Facebook fan page, Costa Rica's Call Center, with 120,000 local Costa Rican Chicos. And naturally, my good friend, when this goes live, everyone's going to see my good friend up in Guanacaste. Once again, I did extend to you that personal invitation. When you are in San Jose, we are here located in Barrio Aranjuez. It's a beautiful three-floor Art Deco building on the corner of 23rd Street and 11th Avenue. And when you're here, buddy, we get to play some air hockey and pinball, and you get to walk the rows and hang out with me and my staff.
I love it. Thank you, Richard. I would really look forward to that, my man. Well, thank you so much, Richard. This has been an amazing conversation, and I really appreciate you being on. And yeah.
You're doing great work, Ash, and I love the work that you do. Your podcast is cool, and the fact that now you're living close.
Well, you know what? We had one of those moments, me and my wife, and we're like, well, if we could move anywhere, where would we move? We were living in Oregon, and that's where I retired out of the military. And we started looking at beaches. I'm a big surfer. I wanted to live near the beach. She's a big beach bunny. And yeah, we've been coming here for years. So I was like, why not Costa Rica? And then at first it started as a joke. And then they're like, why not Costa Rica? Like, why not? Yeah, it was very fast. I mean, that's just how fast things manifest when you really have excitement and inspiration about it. But yeah, it was really fast. So we came down in March. We started looking for a home. We made a couple offers. We got one stuck. And man, that ball started turning real fast. And so, yeah, we sold half of our stuff and moved last month. But anyway, thanks again, Richard. For all of my listeners, that was Richard Blank. I hope you guys enjoyed the show, and we will see you on the next one. Take care.
Well, that's our show. Thanks so much for joining us today. I hope you enjoyed it. And if you ever want to learn more about creating multiple streams of income, wealth protection, financial freedom, or even real estate investing, you're always welcome to check out our website, where you'll be able to invest alongside us on our next investment property or learn from our experience over the last several years through our short-term rental course, which teaches how to buy, set up, and manage your very own luxury Airbnb and create over $50,000 to $100,000 per year out of 1 to 2 rental properties. You can also join our investor club, check out our blog, get our free ebook on investing, or join us for our monthly Real Estate Investing Made Simple virtual meetup. All the content is free, including the meetup, which is held on the last Thursday of every month. We typically have a guest speaker where we explore wealth building as well as different investment strategies to help us accelerate the whole process. If anything, it's a good time. And if you're not having a good time, then are you even winning? But if you're interested, head over to our website. You can find everything you need there. I'll put the link in the show notes, but that's www.valkeregroup.com. And that's spelled V-A-L-K-E-R-E group.com. Thanks again. And I look forward to seeing you there. Take care.